many important issues of convex analysis and its applications, in particular to optimization, are based on duality. In today's lecture, I'm going to talk about the notion of Fanchel conjugates. This is an important notion that plays a crucial role in duality considerations. So let me go ahead and give the definition of the Fanchel conjugate of an extended real value function. Let f from Rn to the extended real line be a function. In this definition, f is not necessarily convex. The Fanchel conjugate of f denoted by f star is defined as follows. F star of V is equal to the supremum of the inner product of V and X minus F of X, where X runs in Rn. Okay, now if we use the relation between the supremum and the infimum, we have the following. This supremum can be rewritten as minus infimum of f of x minus the inner product of v and x, where x runs in Rn. Okay, and over here v is any element of Rn. Okay. So in this way, f star is an extended real value function defined on Rn. And as we can observe from the definition, the value of f star could be minus infinity. Okay, and if we look at this formulation, we can see that the Fanchel conjugate of the function f at v can be defined as the infimum of a perturbation of the function f by a linear function. Now we are going to explore more properties of the Fanchel conjugates of extended real value functions. In the next proposition, I'm going to show that if f is a function that is not necessarily convex with non-empty domain, then its Fanchel conjugate is always a convex function. Let f from Rn to the extended real line be a function. Suppose that the domain of the function f is non-empty. That means there exists x bar in Rn so that f of x bar is less than infinity. Then the Fanchel conjugate is a function defined on Rn, and its values are in the extended real line where minus infinity is excluded. Okay, and moreover, it is a convex function. Okay, so the proof of this proposition is very, very simple. Let me go through the proof. So for any v in Rn, By the definition of the Fentel conjugate, we have that F star of V is equal to the supremum of Vx, the inner product of V and X, minus F of X, where X runs in Rn, okay? And now, because F of X bar is less than infinity for some X bar in Rn, in that case, we're gonna see that F of X bar is just a real number, and from this definition, we see that this is always greater than or equal to the inner product of V and X bar minus F of X bar, okay? And this is just a real number, okay? So from here, we see that F star is defined on Rn, and its values are in this set, okay? So next, I'm going to show that F star is actually a convex function, okay? So we have this representation. F star of V is equal to the supremum of the inner product of V and X minus F of X. Oops. So, as you can see here, this supremum is taken as X runs in Rn. However, if X is not in the domain of the function f, then f of X is equal to infinity. And therefore, if f of X is equal to infinity, then the inner product of V and X minus f of X is minus infinity. Therefore, this sup is actually the same as the sup taken on all X in the domain of the function. So F star of V is equal to the supremum of Vx, the inner product of V and X, minus F of X, where X runs in the domain of the function F. Okay? And this can be written as the supremum of phi X of V, where X runs in the domain of the function F. Where phi x of v is an R phi function defined by the inner product of v and x minus f of x. Okay. As you can see, for each x in the domain of the function, phi v of x here is an R phi function. In that consideration, f of x here is just a constant. Okay. Therefore, from this formulation, we see that F star is the supremum of a family of convex function. And at the beginning, we already know that the supremum of a family of convex function is always convex. Therefore, F star is a convex function. As it is the supremum of a family of convex functions. Okay, and the proof of this proposition is complete. Next is a very, very simple property. It says that if f and g are extended real value functions, and f is less than or equal to g, then the Fentel conjugate of f is greater than or equal to the Fentel conjugate of g. Let f and g be functions defined on Rn, be such that f of x is less than or equal to g of x for all x in Rn, then f star of v is always greater than or equal to g star of v for all v in Rn. Okay, and let me go through the proof. The proof is very, very simple. Okay, so we're gonna fix any v in Rn, then the inner product of v and x minus f of x, as you can see here, f of x is less than or equal to g of x, so the inner product of v and x minus f of x is greater than or equal to the inner product of v and x minus g of x, and this is true for all x in Rn. Okay, therefore, the supremum of this function when x tends to Rn is greater than or equal to the supremum of this function where x tends in Rn. Okay, so therefore f star of v, which is the supremum of the inner product of v and x minus f of x where x tends in Rn, must be greater than or equal to the supremum of the inner product of v and x minus g of x where x runs in Rn, and this is exactly the Fanchel conjugate of the function g of v. Okay, so the proof of the proposition is complete. To understand more about Fanchel conjugates, we are going to go through some examples. In the first example, we are going to calculate the Fanchel conjugate of an R5 function. Let f be a function defined on Rn by f of x is equal to the inner product of a and x plus b. Here a is a vector in Rn and b is a real number, and this function is defined as x runs in Rn. Okay, so this is just an R5 function defined by a vector a in Rn and a real number b. Okay, so from here we're gonna develop a formula in order to compute the Fanchel conjugate of the function f. Okay, so we fix any v in Rn, then the Fanchel conjugate of the function f at v is given by f star of v is the supremum of the inner product of v and x minus f of x, where x runs in Rn. Okay, so this is just the supremum of the inner product of v and x minus the inner product of a and x minus b, where x runs in Rn. Okay, so we can also rewrite it as the supremum of v minus a x, so this is the inner product of v minus a and x minus b, where x runs in Rn. Okay, and observe that b is just a constant, it doesn't depend on x, so this is equal to the supremum of the inner product of v minus a and x, where x runs in Rn minus b. Okay, so we have the following observation: if V minus A is 0, that is, V is equal to A, then this supremum is always 0. And therefore, F star V is just minus B. Okay? In the case where V minus A is a non-zero element of N, then this sup is always infinity. Okay? You can check that easily. And therefore, we end up having that F star V is equal to infinity. Okay? So, we have the following formula. F star V is equal to 0 minus B, which is minus B. So, I can write minus B here. If V does not equal to A and infinity, if, I'm sorry, over here, it's equal to minus B if V is equal to A and infinity if V is not equal to A. Okay? So this is the formula for computing the Fanchel conjugate of an R5 function. And as you can see from here, even if F is a real value function and it's a nice function, it's just a an R5 function, so in particular it's convex, its Fanchel conjugate is still a convex function, but it has extended real values. Okay. Now we're going to work on another example. Consider the function f of x is equal to x to the p over p if x is greater than or equal to 0 and infinity if x is less than 0. Here x is defined on Rn, on R actually, and p is a real number that is greater than 1. Okay, so as you can see, f is an extended real value function in this example. Now, we're going to develop a formula to compute its Fanchel conjugate. So, by the definition, for any V in R, the Fanchel conjugate of V is equal to the supremum of the inner product. In this case, it's just the product because this function is defined on R. So it's just the supremum of V times X minus F of X, where X runs in R. Okay? And as we see earlier, this supremum is equal to the supremum where X is taken on the domain of the function F. So this is equal to the supremum of the product of V and X minus F of X, where X runs in the domain of the function F. And as you can see from the definition of the function F, the domain of the function is the interval 0 to infinity. Okay? And therefore, it is equal to the supremum of Vx minus x to the p over p. Here, x is greater than or equal to 0. Okay? So in order to compute the Fanchel conjugate of V, we look at the following function. So let phi of x be V times x minus x to the p over p. So our goal is to maximize the function 5 on the interval 0 to infinity. Over here, V is fixed in R. Okay? So from calculus, we know how to do this by computing the derivative of the function 5. Then the derivative of the function 5 with respect to x is equal to v minus x to the p minus 1. Okay? So, phi prime of x equals 0 if and only if x to the p minus 1 is equal to v. Okay? At this point, we see that if v is strictly greater than 0, then we can solve for x from here. Okay, so let us consider two cases.
Case one.
V is greater than or equal to 0. I think it's okay if V is equal to 0, because when V is equal to 0, you can also solve for x. X is actually 0 in that case. So in the first case, we consider the values of V in 0 to infinity. Okay. So solving phi prime of x equals 0 gives x equals v to the power of 1 over p minus 1. Okay. And then we construct the following table to see the behavior of the function 5. So x runs from 0 to infinity, and a critical number is v to the power of 1 over p minus 1, and on the second row we look at the derivative of the function 5. At this point the derivative is equal to 0, and if we look at the formula for the derivative of the function 5 prime of x is equal to v minus x to the power of p minus 1, we see that if x is in this interval, then the derivative of 5 is negative. And if x is in this interval, the derivative of 5 is positive. Okay? And therefore, on this interval, the function is increasing, and on this interval, the function is decreasing. Therefore, the function 5 achieves its absolute maximum on this interval when x is equal to v to the power of 1 over p minus 1. Okay, therefore we can calculate phi of v to the power of 1 over p minus 1 and get the following. This is just v times x, and x is this value. So v times v to the power of 1 over p minus 1, and then we subtract x to the p, that is v to the power of 1 over p minus 1 raised to the power of p.
Okay.
Then we end up having v to the power of, this is v to the power of 1, then the exponent is v plus 1 over p minus 1, which is p over p minus 1. So this is v to the power of, over here we have to divide it by p as well, 1 over p, okay? So v to the power of p over p minus 1 minus 1 over p, v to the power of p over p minus 1. Then we can rewrite it as 1 minus 1 over p, and here we have v to the power of 1 over 1 minus 1 over p. Okay, so they are just the same, because as you can see, this is p minus 1 over p, and when we take a 1 and we divide it by that, we have p over p minus 1. Okay, now let q be defined by 1 over q is equal to 1 over by 1 over p plus 1 over q is equal to 1. That is, 1 over q is equal to 1 minus 1 over p. Then from this formula, we see that phi of v to the power of 1 over p minus 1 is actually, this is 1 over q to and v raised to the power of q. Okay. So we obtain the formula f star of v is equal to 1 over q times v to the q, okay? Now, in the case where v is strictly less than 0, case 2, if we look at the formula for computing, it's Van Chow conjugate. This is just the supremum of vx minus f of x, where x is greater than or equal to 0, okay? So this is just the same as the supremum of vx minus x to the p over p, where x is greater than or equal to 0, okay? Observe that if v is strictly less than 0, then this expression is always less than or equal to 0, okay? And in the case where x is equal to 0, it is 0. So the sup is attained at x equals 0, and it is equal to 0, okay? So now if we combine both cases together, we obtain the following formula for computing is Van Chow conjugate. F star of v is equal to v to the q over q. If v is greater than or equal to 0, and infinity if v, and 0 if v is less than 0, okay? So again, this is a new convex function. From the calculations in the previous example, we see that v times x is always less than or equal to x to the p over p plus v to the q over here. V and x are greater than or equal to 0, and p and q are greater than 1, with 1 over p plus 1 over q is equal to 1, okay? And this is called the Young inequality. In the next proposition, we are going to learn a generalization of the Young's inequality that involves the Van Chow conjugate. Let f from Rn to the extended real line be a function with non-empty domain then the following inequality is satisfied. The inner product of v and x is always less than or equal to f of x plus f star of v for all x and v in Rn. Okay? So in this proposition, we require the condition that the domain of f is non-empty so that f star of v is a function from Rn to the extended real line where minus infinity is excluded. Therefore, on the right hand side here, it cannot happen that f of x is infinity while f star of v is minus infinity, okay? So the proof of this proposition is very simple. Let me go ahead and give the detailed proof. By the definition, f star of v is equal to the supremum of the inner product of v and x minus f of x, where x runs in Rn. And this supremum is obviously greater than or equal to v of x, the inner product of v and x minus f of x. Okay, so it follows from here that the inner product of v and x is less than or equal to f of x
plus f star of v. Okay, so therefore we obtain the generalized Young inequality, and the proof is complete.